About we're in 1 John, and I want to just tell you, as I said, we've got some of the missions that are out and all that, and mission people, and but I'm glad to see you here this morning, and we're going to have to make haste because this church is hosting and doing some camp, summer camp stuff, and so they'll be invading this place at 8 o'clock, and we need to be completely gone, so we'll be trying to get the kitchen clean in this place back like we had it before we set it up this way to be good guests of this church. And by the way, we thank God for this church that allow us to come in every, don't really charge us anything, just open the doors and say, hey, come on in. Gave us a key. They come on in and do a men's community Bible study. I was talking on Friday about why Band of Brothers. It's one of the things that I was talking about down in Brunswick. You know, Band of Brothers is a men's community Bible study fellowship breakfast. A men's community Bible study fellowship breakfast. And why everything in that is important. Why men? Why men? Because we need it. Right? Men, every man here could testify to the great need. If you name the name of Christ, you need to be challenged. That's why men. As a man goes, so goes the spot. Where the spot, wherever he is, right? A man, a healthy man in any spot makes that spot better. An unhealthy man will blow up the spot. A home will be blown up by an unhealthy, angry, tyrannical bully. Has brute strength. He can throw his wife around. He can terrorize his kids. Men. And so we need to be challenged. You need to have the junk in your life challenged and pointed out. And I need to have it in my life. And there needs to be an awareness of it, an acknowledgement of it, and a repentance of it. We need to be people, men. The mantle of leadership is ours that God has given to us. And until men reclaim that and appreciate that and understand both the privilege and responsibility of leadership. Right? What do we say about privilege and responsibility? They always travel together, like heads and tails. They just travel together. Right? It's a mighty skinny pancake, ain't got but one side. Right? Two sides to this thing. Right? Privilege and responsibility. And men, golly, you know what I'm talking about. How we get, when we take the mantle of leadership, not rulership, not commandership, not being bosses, but being understanding benevolent leadership. Benevolent leadership, right? When you do what you do for the people you're leading, whether that's your children, grandchildren, your home, in a community, and it's done through love for them, not rah, rah, look at me. The men can get out of the way and be who God's called us to be. Okay. Then community. Why community? Because, we got to get outside the doors of the church, and we've got to invite men. Men need to be exposed to the truth, and we want to make it a community Bible study across denominational line. We want folk to understand, hey, listen, everybody needs to come. This ain't a Baptist thing or Methodist thing or a Presbyterian thing. This ain't a life church thing or Calvary thing or First Baptist Garden City. This community, Christians and men from across the community, we got to have that. So because our community, we inch the ball down the field. When the truth of God is preached and people are challenged by the truth, it's going to have an effect. The word of God is always going to prosper where until God sends it. Not going to return void. It's going to do work. I trust that when you stand up and preach the word of God, that people who leave here, the word of God, listen, will continue to speak. long after my mouth is silent. And I know that. All I have to, my job is to preach the truth. I cannot impart it. The Holy Spirit of God will impart truth. But I can speak it. And when the truth is spoken in the life of men across the community, the ball has been inched down the field for Jesus' sake. Right? So we learn how to, going back to what something Vance said and what I want to talk about, we learn how to see people. We learn how to see the world, right? That's why Bible study. That's why we need to have the truth, the straight edge of the Word of God, the straight edge of God's truth brought across my life. A spiritual circumcision needs to be happening, cutting away the flesh. That's what, and the Word of God does that. The Spirit of God takes the Word of God and does that in our lives. That's why the Bible, that's why we need the truth. If we continue in His Word, we are His disciples for real. Indeed, we will know the truth, and the truth will what? It sets us free from this junk that holds on to us. This junk that holds on to us. Old junk that you learned from your mammy and your pappy, your mom, your dad, your community, your culture, the people you hang around in. You got all kind of stuff holding you. You holding it, but it's holding you. And the truth of God's word is to cut those things. And that's why, you know, the Bible says the Word of God is quick. That means it's living. Right? And it's active. It's powerful. And it divides asunder of joint and marrow. It's like a surgeon's scalpel that divides joint and marrow. And it divides soul and spirit. Your soul and your spirit are so closely aligned that you don't even know there's a difference. If the Word of God didn't tell you that you have a spirit, you don't know you have a spirit. You know you got a soul. You know, how do you know man is not just two parts, physical, and the part that's seen and the part that's not seen? How do we know that man is three parts, spirit, soul, and body? How do we know that? The Word of God tells us there's a difference between the soul and the spirit. And we have spirit, and God is a spirit, and they that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and truth. Lets me know that my body makes me world conscious and my soul makes me self conscious, but my spirit makes me God conscious. Right? And so the Word of God divides between joint and marrow and soul and spirit and thoughts and intents of my heart. That's why you preach the Word of God and let God, the Holy Spirit, take the scalpel and do the dividing in this place. Right? Just do the dividing. Do that cutting, that fine cutting in our lives that needs to be done. That's why nobody sits here. I mean, if the Word of God is preached, nobody is to feel self-justified as the preacher is doing something wrong if he's that group, and this guy over here sits feel smug and satisfied. No. The Spirit of God does something, and he's dealing with this man, and he's got a pride issue, and he's dealing with this man, and he's got a greed issue, and he's dealing with this man. He's got a lust issue, and he's dealing with this dude over here. He's got a fear issue, and this guy's got a guilt issue, and this guy got a racial issue. You know what I'm talking about? When nobody leaves, say, well, boy, the preacher show told him today. Right? It deals with me. That's why the Bible, that's why we have to bring the truth. If we don't, without the Bible, we can't know ourselves, we can't know our children, our wives, the world around us. We can't understand what's going on. It's the interest of His Word gives light. Psalm 119, 130. God is the one who enlightens us to what's going on in the world. You won't understand it. Right? It's the word of God. You understand, man? Men are sinners. That's why you're not very surprised about anything I see today. I mean, I understand that we expel God from the school. You invite violence into the school. You expel God from society. Well, you welcome everything else. I mean, I just understand what's happening. I'm not telling you I've got all the intricate answers, and I don't want to be a simpleton. But I'm just telling you, the Bible will give us the 30,000-foot view of life. And in fellowship, because we need to be iron, it sharpens iron. And fellowship says we share life together, and I need you and you need me. We're not so much dependent and not so much independent, but we're interdependent, the body of Christ, people. You know, right? You realize you need people. And the Bible talks about this over in 1 Corinthians chapter number 12. You know, one part of the body can't say to another part of the body, I have no need of you. Right? My body is interdependent. There's a mutuality in my body for one great. There's one life in here, and all the parts of my body is simply promoting this one life. And there's one life among Christians. That's the life of Jesus Christ. And every part of the body is expressing that one life. See? Everything. You can't know me apart from what you hear my body say or see my body do or identify my body. That's Kenny Grant. 5'6½". Fall out the chair. Good looking. Right. Hey, listen, the truth make you free, guys. Go on, accept it. Be free, my brothers. But you know, you can identify me by my body, and the world ought to be able to identify Christ by his body. What we hear his body say, what we see his body do. Not the body from 2,000 years ago, but the body he's in right now, the body he inhabits right now. All his particular members. Yeah. And then, of course, again, fellowship meal or breakfast. So we're going to do a lunch over in Brunswick. You know, we just do better when we eat. When we sit at the table, we eat, and we, you know, we just, when you eat together. Around in the Bible, you know, the whole idea of eating is fellowship. Right? Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anybody will open the door, I will come in and what? I'll eat with you. I'll sup with you. The idea is I'll fellowship with you. I'll come in and we'll sit at the table and we will break bread together. Right? Even our communion, our Lord's Supper, is woven into our faith to literally bring us to the Lord's table together. To show our communion with him and with one another. It's a visible thing to say, hey, we belong to one another. And we share life. That's what communication is, sharing. That's what participation is, sharing. That's what contribution is, sharing. And that's what fellowship, koinonia, means, sharing. Commonality, that's what that means. Okay, so over in 1 John chapter number 4, as we, you know, don't think we're stuck. We're moving, but we're moving at glacial speed, right? So over in 1 John chapter number 4, where verse number 7, where it says beloved. Remember I told you that word, we're called beloved 5 different times in the book of John, 1 John. Agapetos. We are the loved ones of God. We were talking about, last time I was here, we were talking about love, and I said, well, you know, here's a word we can use. And if I want to try to, let me just tell you this, L-O-V-E, if I could use that sort of as a, not an acrostic, what do you call it, an acronym for love, I would tell you that probably, now this, you won't find this in the chapter and the verse, but love is listening, number one. L, listening. right? We can learn how to listen. If you want to talk about love with street clothes on, when the Bible says over in verse number 18, my little children, let us not love in word, neither in tongue, but in deed and in truth. To my love for real, that word deed there is ergon. Our word ergonomics come from it. Means work. Love is what you do. Not some warm, fuzzy feeling. Not sentimentality. It's what you do. So let us love in what we do. Right? Let us love in ergon. Ergonomically. Right? Expressively. Actively. So if I want to love like that, right, we are beloved. Thank God, God hears us. And we ought to love and hear or listen to one another. I was talking to a man the other day, and I'm going to show you. I've been a preacher for 35 years, been a Christian for 43 years. I was talking to a man who is in some trouble, not legal trouble, but he just kind of sort of bogged down in his life. And so I called him. I said, let's go to breakfast. This was a couple of weeks ago. So we went, and I just wanted to talk to him. And I really had a few things that I wanted to say. Had my points. I've been thinking about what I was going to say to him. And in the course of the conversation, he was talking and he said this. He said, hey, listen to understand, not to respond. He was not saying that so much to me because I wasn't listening to respond. But he was saying this to a family member that frustrated him because they could not hear him because they listen to respond, not to understand. But boy, that was like a grenade went off, because I'm a pastor, I talk to people all the time, and I quite often listen to respond. You know what I'm talking about, Paul? I mean, as preachers, you listen, you sit across the desk, people come, they want answers, they won't help. And I begin to listen to respond rather than listening to understand. And here's the interesting thing. You can't even adequately respond if you don't understand. Duh. You follow what I'm saying? You can be given answers to questions nobody's asking. But again, this is the stuff that keeps us ignorant. It's not what we don't know. It's what we do know that ain't so, that makes us ignorant, right? And so we begin to answer from what we know that ain't so. So you want to love indeed, love for real, love actively, love not just in word, but in deed and in truth. Listen, try that with your son, try that with your daughter, try that with your grandchildren, try that with your wife, try that with your business partner, try that with one another in here. Now listen, everything people say to you ain't right. But how do you know it ain't right? Because you're listening to understand what they're saying. And then at least now you know, okay, now I know they ain't right. Right? But I can't just assume the guy's not right because he doesn't look like me. He's dressed. He's unkempt. He's this. He's that. You know, I'm talking about you. It's easy to walk around thinking I'm right because he's wrong. That he has nothing to contribute. He has nothing to teach me. There's nothing I can learn from him or her. I already know. See how frustrating that might be for a person? Have you ever been on the other side of that conversation? Have you ever been on that side where you're trying to get a word in edgewise, but somebody already know? So, hey, love and deed ergonomically, love and deed and in truth. So if we were going to talk about love, we listen. I've been guilty of not listening. I'm a better husband when I listen. I'm a better dad when I listen. You know, that's one of the things about that song, the little boy, the cats in the cradle. You know, we don't hear what is being said to us. We become tone deaf. Sometimes we don't hear because we're afraid to hear. We're afraid. That's why the Bible talks about fear down here further in the passage about how perfect love casts out fear. Fear is one of the most selfish. Listen, it is the most selfish emotion you have, fear. It's self-protective. Love casts out fear because love is the least selfish thing you can have in your life. Do you follow what I'm saying? You see why, how mature love, a perfect love, not perfect in the sense of just, but a maturing. That word perfect in this passage always speaks of growing up, teleos, growing up love, a love that's progressing and growing to whatever degree it does, fear subsides. Y'all get that? Sometimes we don't listen because we're afraid. We listen defensively. You know, especially men. Our wives can't get a word in to us because we're too busy playing spiritual judo. Or we, you know what I'm talking about? Get that arm, flip her over. And you might win the argument and be losing your wife at the same time. Any witnesses? Like, why am I, you know, fighting with my wife? You can't win that. You can lose a whole lot more than you win. You win. Kudos for you. I beat my wife up. Fight emotionally, physically, whatever it is. So I'm not there. Here's just talking about iron sharpening an iron. I'm just saying, hey, here's an active way. Here's how we love in deed and word. And we're beloved because God, thank God, he hears us when we pray. Amen. He hears our calls. The Bible is clear about that. Thank God he hadn't turned a deaf ear on me. So when the Bible says, let us, verse 8, let us love, one another. Beloved, you've been loved, now love, right? Help me to be a stream, God, not a pool. Right? Not a dead-end reservoir, but a channel of blessing. I have been loved. I am loved. Therefore, I what? Love. I have experienced mercy. Therefore, I express mercy. I have experienced goodness, so I, you follow me? All the things that I'm experiencing from God, I'm to express. That makes me a channel of blessing, not a dead-end reservoir where it's all get, no give. You got to give to live. So, because I am beloved, and he says, love one another. It's like, duh, you are beloved, you are agapetos. You're a loved one, so you love. And you love not just in word. I love you. One of the things, I was talking to a friend yesterday, Clay and I were talking about this, how we throw around the word love, and then when the phone rings, right, we don't love indeed. Don't pick it up and say, what is up? How can I help you? How can I get? So you follow me? Like, that's a challenge to really love. Listen. And then here's a word. When I say this, understand me. Overlook. L-O. Overlook. Overlook. Now, God doesn't wink his eye at our sin. But he knows we're sinners. The Bible says he remembers that we're but dust. He knows our frame. Right? When you love people, you know that they are flawed, but you still love them. Right? You know that they're flawed, and you can overlook the fact that they're human, they're fallen, I'm fallen, and I can accept you. And it is of the Lord's mercies that we're not consumed. If the Lord should count iniquity, I mean, who could stand? So you learn. And so sometimes we say things about love. I remember I preached on love myths. Myths, you know, because we use the word love. And I talked about some of the things about love, like make love. What young people think make love is talking about sex. That ain't making no love. Right? So much of sex is about self, it's just lust. It ain't no, but what's love got to do with all these love, all these words we, sentences and things we throw around the word love, right? Fall in love. That's a, it feels like falling, but let me just tell you, I mean, it's that euphoria. When a boy sees a girl and a girl sees a boy and all this, fall in love. Love ain't no fall. Don't take no effort to fall. If you want to talk about something, love is a climb. Right? It's the exact opposite of falling. There's some effort to loving. But love is blind. That's a myth. Love's not blind, but let me tell you what love is. Love simply overlooks what it sees. It's not blind. You follow me? The prodigal who went out and squandered his dad's money and squandered his dad's name and squandered away all that he had at home, and he comes back in rags with his shoes gone and his life messed up when he comes home. It's not like the dad didn't see this. He just embraced him anyway. Fell on his neck and wept warm, salty tears on his neck and kissed him. And the language really kissed him over and over and over and over and received him. And guess where they wound up? At the table. Fellowship. Wasn't blind to it. Wasn't blind to what he had done. But love can overlook. And if we are to love indeed, like we love, though we see faults in others, does that mean you don't challenge that? No, you've got children that you love. If you sense your little grandsons begin to lie, now wait a minute now. I thought, didn't I just, you know what I'm saying? You got to, you get with that and you try to develop character all the time, right? But if he has that tendency to want to do that, like we all have our tendencies, like, right? Somebody says, what is a lie? A very present help in the time of trouble, right? It's like we'll pull it out to get out of trouble. You know why? Because we don't want no trouble. See, we're fearful of being in trouble, so we lie, something like that. And a little boy would take that road. And you see that, and you don't stop loving him, and you don't overlook it in the sense that you're not trying to challenge that in him. But he's your grandson, and you love him anyway. You don't stop loving him because he's got that tendency. God doesn't stop loving me because of the stuff I promised him I never was going to do again. I find myself doing it again anyway. But he doesn't wink his eye at it. So when I say overlook in the sense of, oh, don't, no. If I love you, you love me, right? What is friendship and kinship and love? Listen, simply says, I want the best for you. That's what a friend is. Friend is a person who wants you to be your best. And I ain't talking about just a pal. Or I'm talking about a friend who wants you to be your best. So in that respect, your parents, when you're born into the world, if your parents are healthy parents, they want the best for you. Right? If you a healthy brother, you got a brother. Hey, you got a brother. You a healthy brother. You want your brother to be his best. Right? Your wife can be your best friend. She wants the best for you. Problem is, we're so selfish. Sometimes it's what's in it for me. And we approach friendships kind of like that rather than in our relationships kind of like that rather than loving. Right? If I can, the illustration is a tick on a dog. You know, a tick on a dog don't care what kind of dog. No tick don't say, well, you know, I prefer German Shepherds. I prefer poodles, long-haired poodles if I could. Ticks don't say that. A tick is just in it for what he can get out of it. You know what I'm talking about? That's a parasite. Just, and so much of what we call love is just us in it for what we can get out of it. Me. And the problem is, with so many relationships, you got two ticks and no dog. That poses a real problem. You know what I'm talking about? Tick married to a tick. And that's where the trouble comes. So, loving actively, loving indeed and not just in word, loving indeed and truth, loving ergonomically, loving work actively, is learning to listen and learning to overlook and learning to value. You remember our word I was talking last week? Value, L-O-V-E, to value. That's a great working word for love, to value. Because we can throw that word around. Do I value my wife? Do I value my children? The value that they have? Hey, look, as I said, around this room, do I value you? Right? Do I see the intrinsic value in you? It's like what Vance was saying. Everybody has this value, and God has gifted us differently, and you know, it's just one of the beautiful things that I'm, you know, at 61, and you begin to take, like, hopefully live life at a higher altitude. You begin to think, I look at a group like this, and I look at a guy who's a salesman, and I look at a guy who's a business executive or a business owner or a musician or a poet, a guy who has just probably been some middle manager, a police officer, a fireman, and I just like marvel at the genius of Jesus, the beauty of the genius of God to number one, give people what he gave them to let them do what they do and get after it. That's why if Tim's up here playing that guitar and he's spewing out these songs he writes, like he writes music at the speed of thought, right? I'm like, marvel, not just at Tim, thank God, but God did this. God gifted this guy his way. How many of y'all know that's a gift? Everybody ain't got it? Well, you might have a beautiful voice, but you just tear it up so bad trying to get it out. It did, nobody knows. But everybody can't do this. Everybody, you're like a business mind to conceptualize something. Like people who develop these subdivisions and bring people together, contractors who know, okay, I got to get this guy here this time. To me, I care about none of those things, but I marvel at people who do it for a living and they can put a business deal together. They can broker something like that. I marvel at that. I see in that the goodness of God because I see the value people have. And if go from the guy who can put that together or the guy who gets out there, wants the driveways poured and get that concrete poured. I mean, spread out. Like, right? You got to have those guys. They can get out there and do that. I mean, I can watch a person by the grace of God do what they are gifted to do or what they know how to do. I can watch them all day. A guy who knows how to work in a yard and do a yard and take a weed eater, and I mean they become skillful, they're good at it. I can watch that. I marvel. I mean, I see people, accountants, like, you know, they go in there and find it and they'll stay at it all day. Y'all would see a mushroom cloud over me. I mean, I'd blow up if I had to sit still and do that all day. But some people have the disposition to sit there and pour over that kind of stuff. Blake's a dentist and this guy's a business guy and there's a lawyer who reads something that thick and call it a brief. Ain't nothing brief about that. Ain't no pictures in it or nothing. Just something that thick. But you see what I'm saying? When you begin to look at the genius of Jesus, pilots, you know, I mean, it's just like, I just love that. What I'm saying, everybody has an intrinsic value and everybody has the, what we call the image of God. You are an image bearer, the imago Dei, right? In Latin, you have the image of God upon you. Do we see people and value people that not just in what they can do, but just that they are people that are loved by God. Therefore, they are valuable, right? That's our value comes from what God was willing to pay for us. Hey, listen, God doesn't love me because I am valuable. I am valuable because he loves me. And because he loves me, that gives me value. Right? And then I would say E is, and again, like this is not chapter and verse, but I was wondering between enduring or engaging, and I might say engaging. Right? Like when I love you, I engage you. Again, love is not standing away, you know, from at some distance theorizing about love. But the people certainly that God brings into my life ought to be engaged. I can't engage everybody. But there are people that God brings across. Here's what I don't want to do. Here's what we ought not want to do. When somebody walks across the threshold of our lives, that's a chance for a close encounter. Right? People I don't know. I mean, I see people on the highway and people passing by. You say, do you love that guy? I love him in theory. But what about the person who walks across the threshold of my life. And I didn't. And I did not know this person. I did not. But here's a person now is in my life, right here in my lane. God's brought that. That's no accident. God knows. All right, Vance. God knows. Right? No accidents with God. No coincidence with God. Not accident, not coincidence. Providence. And they are in my life. What now? They're not just a person passing by in the car. Oh, I love that person in that car. Right? But what about the person who comes across my life? Do I send them back out? Do I engage them? Do I find out what it is that God, what's my assignment here? So, beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone that loves is born of God and knows God. And here's the point of this, that he that loveth not or does not love, all right, he that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. That's the point. And so, I mean, we've circled through this, I guess, like a thread. It goes all the way through the book of 1 John over and over. Here's the great acid test of Christianity is our love for one another. And what these believers thought, that knowledge was love. I mean, knowledge was proof of how close they are with God. And it's sad because I think I see that happen again at church, where what I know and how well I know it is my proof of how close I'm walking with God. So even you sit here and say, boy, that guy, boy, he knows the Bible, or he knows this, that, or he's walking close with God. That ain't necessarily so. Knowledge is not the acid test. Love is. So I can go to a church that rightly divides the Bible, and boy, we have a teaching church, and our pastor's a wonderful Bible teacher, and all of these things, and we think we're better because we know more stuff than other people know. That's not the measure of Christianity. Love is. That's simple. I'm not saying easy, but it is simple. And we can be self-deceived. Father, thank you so much for meeting with us today. And thank you for these men. And thank you for my brothers. And Lord, teach us how to love one another and to be open to love one another, because love is of God, and everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. And those that do not love don't know you in truth, because you love. Teach us that. Let that sink into our hearts. Teach us how to listen and how to overlook the faults in others, God, that we can so clearly see, and value them for who they are, because they have the image bearer, they are image bearers and beloved of God. And God, help us to engage those who come across the threshold of our lives. And we pray and ask it in Christ's name. Amen.